What an amazing job. I was walking the halls a couple Wednesday nights ago, and I heard just this quotation of Scripture just coming out and ringing loud, and I just had to stick my head in there, and they do a phenomenal job. And there's a little bit of nerves up here, as you could imagine, but what a great feat by those young ladies. Make sure you encourage them when you see them after services this morning. So welcome, Bethany Baptist Church. I've been here a little while, and I have been wanting to do this so bad, because during my time before we come here and in waiting, I'd watch so many services, and I watched so many families stand up here and say that, welcome to Bethany Baptist Church. We would love to have a record of your attendance today. And in true Bethany fashion, I can say that now, fold that, and we're going to tear it on the count of three. One, two, three. That was just as fun as I anticipated it being. Now that you have that in your hand, there's a couple things I'd like to call your attention to on that. You are very familiar with that. One is our Wednesday night meal count. If you could, if you're interested in that, you see the information there, sign up, put the number in your family that's going to be here so we can have record and able to make adequate preparations for our Wednesday night meals. Also, prayer request, okay? I know we kind of got out of the habit of this, but was talking with the staff this week. If you have a prayer request, please list it on there, But please also mention your name on there so we know the connection. We sit down every Tuesday morning and we go over these prayer lists and we talk about them, and they are prayed for by name, and then we keep that list and we pray for these prayer requests the rest of the week. This is very important to us as a staff to make sure we have that. So please, once you list your prayer request, please let us know who's making that request as well so we can pray for you along with that. On the back side as well, if you're visiting with us this morning, we'd love to have you fill out just some visitor information. This also comes to our desk. Even if you're just here and you have no intention of coming back again, just leave us a note, leave us your name so that we can just say a prayer for you. If you are interested in becoming a part of Bethany Baptist Church, mark the appropriate boxes there. We'll be in contact with you, giving you some information, and looking forward to building that relationship. So if you would fill that out, and as the offering plate comes through this morning, if you would drop that in there. By the way of announcements, there's several things going on in the life of our church this morning, or this week, this time of year. The first thing I want to call your attention to before I forget it, in Sunday school, most of you or many of you adults were given a survey or a questionnaire from the Vision Casting Committee. I can't express the importance of this enough. I had the opportunity to meet with this committee this past Wednesday night. They're doing some great things, and to be honest with you, what they're doing is not always an easy thing, okay? So what we're doing in this and over these past few weeks is really getting a glimpse of Bethany Baptist Church in the mirror. How many of you looked in the mirror this morning? Some of you did, and I'm not going to mention any of you that didn't, but I'm not going to ask you what you saw or your opinion of what you saw, but a lot of times when we look in the mirror, we don't always like what we see. We see some things we'd like to change. We see some things that we would like to do away with or so forth. And the same way when we look in the life of our church, we're going to see some great things. We're going to see some things we like, but it's also going to reveal some things that we have to work on and that we have need of improving. So this does a great job in helping with that. So if you would please read through this questionnaire. I'm going to go ahead and make this announcement as well. If you notice any grammatical errors or spelling errors, just remember that we are a church of imperfect people. Right, Chris? Anyways, not throwing anybody under the bus there, but please... Please take an opportunity over the next few weeks to fill these out and turn them in, and we would greatly, greatly appreciate that information. This Wednesday night is our business meeting. Brother Chris, the head of that committee, will be giving an update from some previous questionnaires. It'll be a great time to be here. Operation Backpack is going on. That information there is before you. I know it's kind of hard to think about starting back to school next year when we haven't finished out this year, but please be in prayer for that organization as we work to make sure we meet the needs of some in the church, but also a great need in our community as well. Bethany Gold meets this Tuesday at 11 o'clock. You can see the information there. Michael Bush and his wife will be presenting the program that day. Our Annie Armstrong Easter offering, as you notice going through the slides this morning, our church goal is $25,000, and every penny of that given goes straight to the North American Mission Board. You can see the numbers there. 2,900 missionary families serving across will be recipients of these funds. This is just a small way we can help God's kingdom through giving. This afternoon, there's a bridal shower in honor of Madeline Pugh. That information is there as well. The idea was to have an insert in the bulletin today, but guess what? If you notice, it's not there, and it's okay. But if you are willing and interested in helping in the meal and so forth on Palm Sunday with our children's Easter egg hunt, there's a sign-up sheet and some information there as well. If you'd like some more information on some ways you might could help, contact Miss Stephanie Pierce. You can call the church office, and we'll make sure that we get you all the information that you need there. This is a big time in the life of our church. You get into Palm Sunday, Easter Sunday. We have an opportunity to reach those that we might not normally be able to reach. So let's make every effort that we do that here today. That's a mouthful of announcements. I think I got most of them, but I hope you are prepared to worship today. I hope your goal when you woke up this morning was to come to church and to make much of the name of Jesus Christ and to worship Him. One thing I want you to do before we stand up, and you can go and be making your way to your feet as we start our fellowship hymn. I want you to look around and notice someone who's not here. It's probably pretty easy to do. You may know exactly where they're at. They may be visiting family. Go ahead and stand up. And as you do that, notice and just send them a text message this afternoon. You don't have to ask where they were, what they were doing. Just say, we missed you in worship today. At this time, you may fellowship with your brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you.
everybody. Y'all come on and find your way back, and we're going to sing all the verses of Nothing But the Blood of Jesus. All right, here we go. Let's sing it out together. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Whole again. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow.
Sound good, choir. That's going to be in the adult choir this week and the kids choir this week. All right, before we sing this next one, why are we singing the songs we're singing? We're going to use some fancy words. The first fancy word is justification. That means where Jesus comes into your life initially for the first time and saves you from sin. Listen to these verses. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation, say that fast, by his blood, to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus Christ. And real quick, we're going to sing about sanctification, about walking with God and how we see his power in our life and how he helps us to have power, the power over sin. It's by him that we can do this. Listen to what the Bible says. Sanctify them in truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sake, I consecrate myself, that they also may be sanctified in truth. That was talking about the disciples, but then he goes on and talks about me and you. I do not only ask for these disciples, but also for those who will believe in me through their word. So we believe in their word, the word of the Lord Jesus Christ. So let's sing this powerful song of our faith, and it talks about us walking with Jesus and being saved from the power of sin through him. One more time. I'm sorry, Coach. One more time. Let me get my ear fixed real quick. You know what? I don't need these. This came off right here. We're just going to throw that back there. I'll try to hear. Go for it. Singing. Isn't that a powerful song? It sure is. Let the cross be our glory and the Lord be our song. One more quick verse I want to share with you. We're going to talk about the God who glorifies. Listen to this. It's talking about our future glory, how Jesus will one day save us from the presence of sin. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is revealed to us. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. For those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he glorified. Last one. Our citizenship as believers is in heaven. And from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body by the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself. All power and glory be to the Lord Jesus Christ. I heard a preacher say one time, I want the pie in the sky by and by, and that's what we're about to sing when we sing I'll Fly Away. But I also want some steak on my plate while I wait. And so that's the other songs we've been singing. So this is the pie in the sky by and by. Let's sing I'll Fly Away. All verses. Presence of sin by Jesus Christ.
Amen and amen. As you remain standing, we'd ask our ushers to come forward this morning to receive our tithes and offerings.
Lord, I thank you for the day. A beautiful day you've given us to come to. I honor you and I praise you and I worship you because you're Jesus. the living, resurrected Son of the Holy Father. We ask thee now to be with us in the services today. We pray, Lord, that if someone that has entered these walls that does not know thee, they will not leave as they entered. Lord, if you would, bless the gift as well as the giver. Bless each family that's represented here. Go with us now and be with each and every one of us, for it's in your precious. In the holy name I do pray. Amen.
Miss Pat, and now what all the children have been waiting for. Children, start your engines, I guess we say. You are dismissed to Children's Church. I'd like to turn with me in your Bibles to the Gospel according to Luke, Luke chapter 10 this morning. We're going from one end of the spectrum to the other. Last Sunday, we spent some time on the topic and the destination and the place called hell. The realities of that, it was an actual place, it was an awful place. And we're going to the other end of the spectrum. Hell is a place where there is no Jesus. Hell is a place where there is no Christ. Hell is a place where there is no God. It is actually as far as you can get from Christ and God. But we're going to go back to the other end of the spectrum this morning, and we're going to find a place at the feet of Jesus. Finding a place at the feet of Jesus. As I begin to prepare this message, I had things laid out here, and as I'll mention, we come across Mary three times in Scripture, and each time we find her, she finds herself at the feet of Jesus. And I had it laid out there all three times, and the Lord said, "That's too much." And God's people said, "Amen," right? I said, "Okay, Lord, we'll take off this last one." And the Lord said, "That's too much." And God's people said, "Amen." And I said, "Oh, okay, Lord, we're trimming it pretty thin here. What about just this first one?" And the Lord said, "That's what I want." And God's people said, "Amen." But that doesn't mean it's going to be short, by the way. Just so you know. But there in Luke chapter 10, verse 38 through verse 42, let's examine these verses together this morning. The Bible says there in verse 38, "Now it came to pass as they went that he entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was cumbered about much serving and came to him and said, 'Lord, dost thou not care that my sister hath left me to serve alone? Bid her therefore that she help me.' And Jesus answered and said unto her, 'Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things. But one thing is needful, and Mary hath chosen that good part, which shall not be taken away from her.'" Let's pray. Father, we thank you, God, for this time that we have to come together and worship, to sing your praises and to study your scriptures. Father, I pray that today that we would make much of your Son, and Father, we would recognize his presence here today. Father, will you give us the comfort in your word that where two or three are gathered, there are you in the midst of them. Father, we know that you are here among us today. Father, I pray that you would move in a mighty way among your people. Father, I pray that we would recognize that spirit. We could recognize that presence, God, that we would be burdened and pricked at the heart, Father, to draw closer and to draw nigher in that relationship with you. Father, I pray that we're careful this morning to give you all the honor, all the praise, and all the glory for all the things that you're going to do. It's in your precious Son's name we pray. Amen. Have you ever met an individual that just seemed to have God all over them? It seemed that they walked a walk with the Lord that was head and shoulders above anything that you've ever witnessed or ever experienced yourself, and you just wonder how they accomplished it. And probably as I just mentioned that, there may have been some heroes of your faith that come through your mind at that time, that these men or these ladies, that they walked with God and they were always close to God, and it seemed like the presence of God always rested upon them, and there was always a gleam from their faith, there was always wisdom to come from their lips. And you just wonder, oh man, what a spectacular feat that is. How do they do that? Well, I've been the same way. I've seen those people. I have those people in my life as well. And I think we can figure out where that answer lies. I think it's discovered here in this passage of Scripture this morning. It seems that some have learned to abide at the feet of Jesus as they go through life, and this translates into a peace of heart, a power of life, and a purpose before God. So this morning, I want to take a few moments and let's notice this story here with Martha and with Mary, and let's notice that we today probably need to spend some time, or let me just rephrase that, we today need to spend more time at the feet of Jesus. I don't know about you, but I can say I want that kind of life for myself. I want to be that one that when someone sees me, they don't see me, they see the love of Christ and the attitude of Christ and the mind of Christ radiate through me. And we only come to that and find that at the feet of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The Gospels mention this lady by the name of Mary here in our Scripture this morning. She is a popular lady. She's only mentioned the three times, but we know her quite well. We know that she is the sister of Lazarus. We know that she is the sister of Martha, and is found in several different scenes throughout the Scripture. And as we notice her experience, I think we can find a place of stillness this morning at the feet of Jesus. So one thing this morning, as far as you can call it a title, a heading, I like to do everything in outline form so I don't chase too many rabbits along the way. But as we think about this morning, at spending some time at the feet of Jesus, let me inform you, first of all, as we spend time at the feet of Christ, it is a place of stillness. It's a place of stillness, and we see the context of this story this morning in the verses that we've read. Jesus is traveling through, and it came to pass as they went, he entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. Now, Martha said she saw a good thing. She knew of Christ. She had met him, and she said, I want you to come and spend some time in my home today. And we know how that story goes on. Martha opened up her heart to do a very good thing, and Mary, on the other hand, opened her heart to Jesus and just did what she could to love on him and to grow in him and to spend some time with him. Probably too often in our lives, we find ourselves more like Martha than we do like Mary. Now, notice what Martha was doing was not a bad thing. He even said, Jesus even said at the end of the passage, some of those things you're doing are needful. Now, I'm sure she was up making sure everything was straight. She was cleaning, she was straightening, she was cooking, and she had it going on. Have you ever went to someone's house that's invited you to dinner and they don't really have much time to visit because they're finishing everything up, they're setting the glasses, they're putting ice in the glasses, they're making sure that everything's finishing up, making sure the dessert's not burning in the oven, and everything's just wide open and it smells good. You're like, this is not bad. That was Martha. Martha was making sure everything was ready. So in the grand scheme of all, being a Martha in that setting was not a horrible thing to do. But there was always something better. But there was a sister there named Mary. And Mary found her comfort. As Martha was cumbered, as the scripture says, Mary was peaceful. Mary was taking some time, soaking everything in at the feet of Jesus. She found a place of stillness at the feet of Jesus. And that's a place where we can do several things this morning. Four. Bear with me. I know. It could have been 12, but it's four. Just remember that. Four things that we can find at that place of stillness. Mary found a place where she could forget her cares. So as we find our place at the feet of our Savior this morning, understand that we can find a place of stillness there where we can forget about our cares. We see here, as we mentioned, Martha was cumbered with serving. In other words, she was distracted. As we would say in today's society, she was running wide open, like a chicken with her head cut off, like a dog chasing his tail. You know how that goes. You stay busy, but you don't get much done. Does that describe anybody here today? But that was Martha in that. But while Mary was sitting calmly listening to the words of Jesus, I want you to think about that picture just for a moment here this morning. When we come into His presence, how do we come into His presence today? Well, by reading our Bible, by worshiping, by studying, by praising Him. Me and Jason had some time this week, and while I'm busy in the office doing some things there, I'll pull up the old YouTube and I'll listen to old gospel music. That's kind of my niche. And he came in there and he said, I got to pull up a seat by him. We listened to some powerful songs and hymns of the faith. And I said, you know what? I don't shout in church, but when I'm riding down the road with myself, listening to some of these songs, the Spirit just gets all over me. And that's some of the best times of worship and closeness that we can have with our Savior. Those times of worship and giving Him praise. And in those times, as we find ourselves in those moments, we notice that the burdens of the world tend to grow amazingly light. The cares of the world begin to move slowly away. It would do many Christians good to just to sit and to learn to sit in His presence and to forget about the cares of the world. There are some of you here this morning that as we are in the house of the Lord and we're singing praise and worship, wow, it doesn't get a lot better than what we've had this morning, folks. But even through the midst of that, and this preacher says he's trimmed down his sermon to a third, and you're thinking, well, it's still going to be long, and I've got so much to do today. Man, there's just so much going on. You may be sitting there, and you may have your grocery list beside you. Oh, I need to make sure I have this, this, and this for the kids' lunches this week. Oh, man, we've got ball games every night this week. What are we going to do for supper this night, this night? We've got church Wednesday night. How many do I need to sign up for? And we're sitting here and we're thinking about all those things of the week. And we're sitting about all the things that even come along with church today. Man, we had a deacon's meeting this morning. We talked about this. How am I going to solve this issue? What are we going to do to make sure this works? What are we going to do to make sure this happens? How are we going to keep the preacher happy? What can we do to make the preacher mad? All those things come through our minds, right? And I'm not naive. I've not always stood in this pulpit. I've sat where you are. But we find ourselves getting so busy mentally, even while sitting in a worship service, that we fail to take the time to just get at the feet of Jesus and to spend some time studying Him and worshiping Him and praising Him and making much of Him, that we never allow those burdens and cares of the world to slide away. Can I tell you it's okay to do that this morning? You can let those cares slide away. You can let them roll on to the side. You'll have time to do those things later, because I promise you when you leave here, those things will come back to you. But take some time this morning to mentally take some time and get at the feet of Jesus and soak in His sweet goodness, in His glory, in His Word, and let those fears, let those things of the world slowly move away. We need to learn to love the Lord more than our worries. I'm going to stand before you and say that I am a worrier. Anybody here a worrier? Anybody here a liar? Okay. We worry. Some of our human nature is worry, anxiety. I've been there. Sometimes I stay there for longer. We need to love the Lord more than our worries and concerns. It's like, Brother Richie, how do I do that? Well, you spend time with Him. You spend time with Him. You turn your phone off. You get away a little bit. You put your list up and you just say, Lord, here I am. When Mary found herself at the feet of Jesus, what did she say? The Bible says she was there and she listened to Him. How long has it been since you've gotten still enough to listen to Him? What does God's Word say? Be still and know that I am God. There is a time to go. The Great Commission tells us to go, but let me remind you, there is also a time to be still. There's also a time to find that peace at His feet. You know, we listen better when we're still. We listen better when we're not trying to do other tasks ourselves. I don't have to go into your home to understand this. If you've been listening in my home, you might hear this, that has your wife ever asked you to do something and you were doing something else that was important and you just, I get you. And then 5 minutes later, well, why didn't you do this? Well, you didn't ask me to do that. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Anybody identify? You know, that's why many people are wondering today, I wonder what God wants me to do with my life. It's not because He hasn't told you. You've not been a Christian 20 years and not know what God wants to do because He hasn't spoke to you. If you're wondering where you are in your life right now, where you are in your spiritual life, it's not because He hasn't led you and showed you. It's probably because you haven't been still enough to listen. And this morning, we must find some time to be still at the feet of Jesus, a place of stillness where we can forget our cares. It's also a place where we can feed our souls. Verse 39 says, and she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard His word. Martha was concerned over the physical nourishment, while Mary was more concerned about getting her soul fed. In His presence, we'll find food for our souls and strength for our journey. Anybody ever just get run down, tired? Man, I'm just in a rut. It's the same thing day in, day out. It's like the repeat button is stuck. If we'll just feed our souls and get in with Him and spend some time at His feet, we'll be fed. We'll find strength for our journey. We'll find our hope. We'll be revived. It's no wonder that many Christians are weak and lacking in spiritual vitality. We never take the time just to come into His presence and feed on Him. Let me let you know a little bit of secret. This is not just for common folks. This is true for Sunday school teachers. It's true for deacons. It's true for pastors. It's true for youth pastors. It's true for worship pastors. Sometimes we get so cumbered with the load that we carry that we miss the Jesus that we're serving. Sometimes we get so bundled with the chores of the world that we miss our time with Him. When I was younger, there was a gentleman that came. He was a missionary, and he spoke at my home church. And this has been 25, 30 years ago. I was young. And I remember he spoke in a modern-day parable. And he spoke as if he was in that person. He talked, and I can't remember it word for word, but I'll give you a good summarization of it. This young man went to spend some time with his grandparents on the farm. And as he got there that evening, and he was watching TV, reclining on the couch, and his grandfather said, "Son, you probably want to go ahead and turn in for the night. Tomorrow's a busy day." And he said, "I'm here just spending some time with my family. It can't be that bad." So he said, "I watched a few more episodes of the TV show, and finally I went to rest." He said, "The next morning at 5:30, the alarm went off, and it was time to work." He said, "I got out that morning," he said, "and I milked the cows," he said, "I fed the hogs," he said, "I chopped some wood," and he said, "I was just dying of hunger." He said, he heard that breakfast bell ring. He just being wiped out from what he thought was a morning of work, went in, and he had the biggest breakfast you could imagine. It was good, and it was great, and all the biscuits, and the meat, and the gravy, and the eggs, and all of that. And after he got through, he went and reclined, and he sat down. And his grandfather says, "Son, what are you doing?" He said, "The work's yet to be had." And he said, "But this time I was irritated." He said, "What do you mean the work's yet to be had?" He said, "I woke up at 5:30 this morning. I went outside. I milked all the cows, brought that in. I chopped all the wood for the fire so you could have that. No problems. I fed the hogs. I checked on all the other animals. I watered them. I made sure everything was good all morning. And now I come in just to sit down just for a moment. And you tell me that the work hasn't really been going on?" He said, "No, son." He said, "You've been doing the chores." He said, "The real work begins in the field." I say that to tell you this. Don't get so overloaded with the chores, the busyness, the things, that we miss the work of what we're really called to do in the fields and spending time with Jesus. When we're at His feet, we can find food for our souls. We just take some time. He'll feed us spiritually. Moving on this morning, not only will we find a place we can forget about our cares and feed our souls, it's a place we can focus our priorities. It's a place where we can focus our priorities. We see that again in verse 39. Looking on into this scene in Martha's home, we can tell what each sister's priorities are. Martha was concerned with preparing the meal and serving her guests. Mary, however, was more concerned with being in the presence of the Lord Himself. Listen carefully. Often the level of spirituality we are able to achieve in life is directly related to the time we're willing to spend in His presence. Let me say that one more time. Often the level of spirituality we are able to achieve in this life is directly related to the time we are willing to spend in His presence. I'm going to tell you this morning something that might make you mad, it may break your heart, but it's the truth. You are as close to God today as you desire to be. You are as close to God today as you desire to be. If you wish to draw closer to God, do it. Draw closer to God. He's not the one that's running away. He's not the one who has turned His back. If it's a priority that we want and desire that relationship with Him. If everything else in our lives takes precedence over us being with the Lord, then we are in danger, and we are in a great danger at the heart of our experience. It simply boils down to priorities. And boy, do we have a lot of them. You notice I don't speak you, I speak we. How are our priorities? We all have them. We all go in different directions. But what's important to you? Whatever is important to you is what will be important to your family. What's the most important thing you do on a daily basis? That's what your children are going to read into. What's the most important thing you do on a Sunday? That's what your child is going to find the most important thing in their lives as well. Sundays are meant for worship. Don't want to get off on a bad foot here, but Sundays are meant for worship. Our main desire every day, but especially as we come for corporate worship, is to bring much honor and glory to the name of Jesus Christ. Can I tell you what the most important thing in your life is? Is what do you rearrange your schedule for? What do we rearrange our schedule for? The things we move around are really not as important as the things we focus on, right? I had a person that I taught with at one time, and I'm not going to obviously mention any names with the whole YouTube world and Facebook world. I don't think there's any way they would watch it, but somebody might, and I'm not just mentioning a name. But had a conversation, and their child, she was a wife of a pastor, and they, Lord, if they crucify me on this hill, I'll die with you. But they played the travel ball thing. Sorry. He went there. And it's okay. And she said, but we never missed a service on a Sunday. I said, that's great. She said, we always found a service that fit our schedule. Pastor's wife. If you don't want to know what I think, please don't ask me. Brother Richie, what do you think about that? I think you messed up. But we were at church. I said, what did you show your child was most important that day? What schedule did you rearrange? What schedule did you change? What did you show your child was most important that day? We're going to rearrange our church schedule so we can say we worship, but yet we went to worship something else. I'm sorry. It's the truth. There's more, and I've said this before, this is going to be silly, but it's going to sink into you one day. There's more bass boats and billy goats sending folks to hell than any bar and saloon every wheel. Because we as Christians today hide in our possessions and hide in our personal lives that we want to live that and play church and play God. You go to the lake, you go to the ball field, and you're going to find people, I'm a Christian. We had a devotion before we come here. Our church met in worship, but we read a scripture along the way. We had a prayer along the way. And if you do that, that's great. If God has not convicted you of that, maybe He will or maybe He won't. You be that guiding voice. But you make much of Jesus in your family. You make much of Jesus in your home. You make Jesus your priority, or He will never be a priority in your children's lives. That's the reason the church is in the shape that it is today. Because we have failed generation after generation about making life about the most important thing, and that is our relationship with Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. When we spend some time at the feet of Jesus, we'll get our priorities in order. Notice what Martha was doing. Was it bad? Absolutely not. She was preparing a meal for the king. But there was something she could be doing better, and that was sitting at His feet and learning from Him. This morning, today, maybe we can focus our priorities a little more, a little better, if we'll spend some time at the feet of Jesus. Then lastly, as we close this morning, at the feet of Jesus, we find stillness and we can find ourselves. We can just find who we really are and who we want to be. It says in verse 42, but one thing is needful, and Mary hath chosen the good part which shall not be taken away from her. We find that place at the feet of Jesus, that place of stillness. We find a place where we can find ourselves. And sitting at the feet of Jesus, Mary found fulfillment and contentment. What she found in Jesus that day was something more important than money could ever buy, something more important than anything in the world could ever offer. In fact, just by taking a few moments and sitting at the feet of Jesus, Mary found something that millions live their entire lives and never discover. She found peace, she found acceptance and true contentment by spending some time at the feet of Jesus. Those two things alone are more worthy of spending time in His presence. They're worth spending His time. Christians could learn a lot about the value of spending time at His feet. You know, we all fight battles, and we all fight our demons. I'm real with you. I'm with you. Do you know why we're overcome with them more than we conquer them, because we don't spend enough time at the feet of Jesus. I'm not saying that every issue you've ever had will be solved by spending 5 minutes at the feet of Jesus, but you'll be amazed at how much it helps. Last week we talked about the evils of hell. As far away as Christ as one could be. We decided last week that's not a place we want to go. That's not a place we want to be. But today we look at the other side. Are you as close to Christ as you should be? Remember, you're as close as you want to be. But are you as close as you should be this morning? I don't know all the extra that goes on in your life. I can only imagine by the extra that goes on in my life. But this morning, if we would just put that aside, and even if you can't put it aside, just spend some time with Jesus. He'll take it away. This morning, I'm sure there's several that just needs to come fall on their faces and say, Lord, I just need to spend more time with you. Lord, I need to get some things right. I need you to help me get some things right. Lord, I need you. I just need to spend some time at your feet. And once you get there, you don't have to say a word. He'll speak, and when he's silent, soak in his goodness, soak in his grace, and soak in his mercy. Have you found your place at the feet of Jesus? Let's pray. Father, we come to you this morning. Father, as we enter into this time of invitation, Father, I pray that where you have burdened and convicted this morning, there would be a response to you and a response for you. Father, I pray that each and every child of God here today would make a decision, Father, to spend more time at your feet, to spend more time in your stillness, in your presence, and in your glory. Father, I pray that you give courage to those who stand in need of it today. It's in your precious Son's name we pray. Amen. If you would stand with me, please.
Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Search me and try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now, as in thy presence, humbly I bow. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Power, all power, surely is thine. Touch me and heal me, Savior divine. Have thine own. Have thine own way. Hold o'er my being absolute.
How sweet His presence is. May we enjoy the sweetness of it that we desire to spend it there. I think of Peter, James, and John when they went up to the Mount of Transfiguration, where Jesus revealed Himself in all of His splendor and His glory. And they said, Lord, this is good. Let's just pitch a tent for y'all and let's just stay here. May we enjoy His presence that much. We're going to end with a word of prayer, and if something's changed, I'm going to take the boot fart to catch a rock instead of my man back here. Before I got up here to preach, I said, man, that was good. I said, do you think we might could close with I'll Fly Away instead of the doxology? If that offends you, I'm sorry. But after our prayer, we're going to talk about that glorification stage once again, that one day we're going home to bask and to live in His presence forever. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for who You are. Father, we thank You for Your Spirit. We thank You for the guidance and the peace that it gives. Father, I pray today that our desire would be, God, is to sit more at Your feet and to learn from Your Word and to learn of Your goodness and to bask and enjoy Your presence. It's in Your precious Son's name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Okay, let's see if we can clap together. Hey, James, could you put up that third verse? We'll do the third verse. And here we go. Well, just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away. Here we go. Oh, I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away in the morning. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Have a good evening.